confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. Now listen, folks, that's no accident. That is the heart of the whole thing. Any religion that does not have the shedding of blood in an atoning way doesn't cut it. So here, okay, by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain. Now we're referencing something in the tabernacle and something in the temple that when Jesus died was affected, but wait, it's more than that. Because remember, I talked to you about how Jesus tabernacled with us. So the curtain, whatever it was that veiled God from us, was ripped wide open. Okay, so keep this in mind. This gets to be big stuff. Open for us through the curtain, that is, his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, now here it is. Verse 22, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Man. Father, thank you for these words. We're going to comb them out just a little bit and think about what you have given us along with Jesus Christ and in the atoning work of Jesus Christ. This gift that we have just celebrated having received is so big and wonderful. But may it not just be something heady. Help us to have a heartfelt experience. And I ask all of this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You know, I can almost get excited about this. If I'm not careful, I may get to start preaching here pretty soon. So hang on. Stay with me. Isn't this good? I didn't write this book. I just find this stuff. And it's just absolutely awesome. Now look, I'm keenly aware that as we come to the new year, everybody has a way of celebrating it, and everybody does all different kinds of things. And one of the things that traditionally everybody's going to try to do is they're going to look back and say, you know, I really clubbed up a few times this year. I'm going to make the New Year's resolutions, and next year's going to be better. But that's what they said last year. That's what they said the year before that. And there's a sense in which trying to pick yourself up by your bootstraps doesn't work. It doesn't matter how hard you pull on your shoestrings, you can't lift yourself up. And we do all kinds of things in human effort, and every time we will fall short. We fail. So, it looks to me like, if I'm honest with myself, trying harder, trying just to do better, isn't enough. But what if? And I'll borrow this picture. You guys probably saw the film. I've been watching a lot of it, but I found it on the internet, so I know about it. Okay. What if there was really some kind of a gate that you and I could walk through that would make us different and make life different, and we could not only have hope, but we could be guaranteed success. The success of living well. What is it? Well, I want you to know that's the Bible story. That's what the gospel is. Now, God's word has been very clear, and in my society today, we are ignoring scripture, so we are ignorant, because we have ignored, we are ignorant of the problem. So we have a tendency to think that if everyone had just a little more money, if everyone had just a little better environment, if we just had a few more laws on the books, oh no, that didn't do it. So if we had a few more policemen to enforce the laws that we have on the books, oh, that's not doing it either too well. If everybody just had more education, no way. if not work upon. We're coming apart at the seams as a society, as we have moved away from this book and the God of this book. Oh, we grew up and evolved to the point where we don't need this old-fashioned stuff, but how's it working? You see, the Bible says that man is lost. That means that he doesn't know the right way. It means that he's alienated. Man, and loneliness is something that, it isn't that there aren't people around, it's that we're disconnected from everybody, and we're, because we're disconnected from God. Exile. You know, we have lost access to the spirit realm, but we are spirits, so we're looking in all kinds of mysticism and all kinds of New Age stuff and all kinds of spiritism, and man, we're trying to find some way to reconnect back to the spirit world. Back when I was in college, we were denying the spirit world. We could solve everything with psychology and science, and now we're looking into the spirit world, but we're looking in all the wrong places. Because the Bible says the problem is we're separated from God, the God who is holy, the God who is real. Not only that, but because we've gotten disconnected from God, we're disconnected in lots of other ways. We have lost what the Bible calls spiritual life. There is something missing. So we're stuffing ourselves with everything. Drugs, alcohol, food, fun. Man, we're really hard-pressed to find something to satisfy. Nothing satisfies. There's a hopelessness and a helplessness. There is no purpose in our lives. And dysfunction. My goodness, dysfunction. You know, counseling, I've been trained in this stuff. I ought to be able to help people with counseling, and I have found that it doesn't work too well. A few years ago, we were meeting as pastors, and I met up with Deb Copenhagen's Cafe in Creston. And the preachers that I met with were studying a book. The title of the book is I'm Okay, You're Okay. And the man, they were going through this book. I said, why? Well, we thought maybe it'd help us and help us help people. And I said, you know, guys, I'm really kind of young at all this, but I find that without the transforming grace of God in Christ Jesus, we're not okay, and nothing helps. And they all looked at me like, what planet did I come in on? There was one old Methodist preacher that looked at the rest of the guys and said, you know, guys, he's right. He's absolutely dead on. This Methodist preacher said, when I was in seminary, I decided that I wanted to really help people, so I chose a counseling track. And I have a master's degree in clinical counseling. And I have spent my career trying to help people through counseling, and I'll have to tell you, I have been an absolute failure. This man is right. Without the transforming touch of God in Christ Jesus, nothing changes us. Those preachers put the old book away and said, what should we study? I said, well, I don't share anything. Why don't we share the distinctive of our denomination? Then it was fun what happened from there on. Several months went by, and I've got some great stories to tell about all of that. Today, people are looking for a counselor. Yoga classes. Oh my, we exercise. We do the weight loss stuff. We, man alive, the dysfunctions that we've got in our society are many, and they're everywhere. Jesus Christ has come because we needed help living a wholesome life. Am I making sense? I didn't write this book. I just read about it, and it seems to me so on track, absolutely. So, the cure for both individual and societal ills seems to me to honestly be to reconnect with the God of the Bible. We wouldn't know about him except for the Bible. Oh yeah, Jesus came. The Bible tells us he came, and that's the record we have, and so we can see him come and the difference he makes. We can hear the words. We can watch the people down through the centuries that have decided to live the Jesus way, and we can see the difference it makes in individual life and in society. There's a guy that did a study. He decided, and he was an unbeliever, incidentally. He thought that religion was a bunch of nonsense. But he decided to study for a master's thesis what influence missionaries have. The conclusion is that anywhere in the world that there has been a missionary, even if he was not a good missionary, is that the economy is better, the government is more stable, and society is safer and better. Everywhere there has been a missionary in the world, and he converted to Christianity during his master's thesis. So I believe that the answer to the human dilemma, everywhere we go, is that we need to reconnect with the living God and be restored to who we're supposed to be, so that we can do what we're supposed to do and be what we're supposed to be in every way. I want you to know that effort doesn't work. More effort does not change people, and it does not change society. I also want you to know that religion is a failure. Now listen, it doesn't matter whether your religion is Islam or Hinduism or Christianity, if all you have is the system and the religion without the transforming touch of God in Christ Jesus, it won't work. So, we talk about Ireland. Ireland, you know, the green is Roman Catholic and the orange is Protestant, and they fight all the time. And somebody said, what if Christianity really works? And I said, they're not Christians. They're not following Christ Jesus. If they were, those problems would be gone. So I am convinced that it is only through Christ Jesus that there is a solution to the human dilemma. And I want to be clear, it's not what we have. So go into Walmart or Costco or whatever and buy another thing, I'm going to cut it. And it's not what we have done. You know, it is really interesting, really easy for a guy like me in pastoral ministry to think that if I work a little harder, if I find ways to be with more people, if I preach better, that somehow what I do is going to make a difference. You know what? What I do doesn't change people. Now that doesn't excuse laziness or disconnectedness. In order for Jesus to come, I have to be where people are, but it is his coming that makes the transforming difference. So it's who we know and what we are. Not what we do, what we are. Isn't it interesting that in our English language we are called human beings, not human doing. We're human beings. It's what we are. And we need to be Christ-like if we are to make any difference. Man, it's taken me a long time and a lot of study to get this stuff focused. You know, I'm giving you the essence of this. Okay, I don't know how you came up, but man, when I came up, junior high was traumatic. I got teased. They made fun of me. I had a self-image that was lower than a snake's belly. Now listen, I could tell you a story. When I hit junior high, they didn't think I was going to be able to handle the seventh grade because my mother showed them that I had done some correspondence courses, and they didn't think that would cut it, so I wasn't going to be able to cut the mustard in seventh grade. So they put me in some kind of dumbbell math class. I have been a lot better off if they let me have algebra or something that made sense. But they made me have long lists of numbers, you know, stuff that was actually stupid. And there was a whole bunch of other stuff that went. But can you imagine how it makes you feel when the administrators tell you, well, you know, he's not smart enough to fit in our school. He's a dumbbell. That, you understand? That really helps your self-image. And then we went out on a beautiful day for PE, and we're going to play football. Man, I knew football. I played lots of football. I was pretty good at it. But they pulled out the funniest ball I'd ever seen in my life, and they weren't playing with their feet. It wasn't football. And I ask somebody, what are we doing? And they say, we're playing football, you dummy. Now, that is literally what happened to me. Can you imagine how I feel about football? Well, yeah, I don't get too involved with that kind of stuff. All right. I can tell you on, and it didn't matter. I came to this church as a pastor, and I couldn't spell. I came out of seminary, and I couldn't spell. And every time I turn around, somebody says, hey, you got to misspell a word. Well, you know, why don't you buy a dictionary? Okay? It goes on and on and on. I have climbed out of a hole. I finally decided that it really doesn't matter what everybody thinks of me. I'm going to just be what God created, and I'm going to do what he asked me to do. And it's amazing the freedom that I have found in just being me and not trying to please everybody. How do you do with all that stuff? You know what I'm talking about? Okay, so it's really easy to come and feel unworthy about who I am. I'm really a nobody. I was born on the wrong side of the track. I wasn't born in an influential family. I don't know. Yeah, we can go through all kinds of stuff. And somebody comes and says, God wants fellowship with me. God loves me. He delights to hear my prayers and my praise. He wants to influence my life on a step-by-step basis. You know, if God knew who I really was, if God knew what I had done, if God knew my, if God could see my work, but you know what? God knows you better than anybody else. And he loves you. He loves me. But it doesn't seem to matter. I know that I have a dark spot in my heart. And I have a tendency to want to roll the dark spot down away from God's white hot light. And then I kind of like to play with that dark spot. But I learned a long time ago that what really helps is to roll that dark spot up into the light of God's presence and let it be cleansed away. And so I read a passage like this, and all of a sudden it begins to make sense to me that God has given me something. Sometimes I hear people talk about how far away God is. Can't hear him talk. Never have felt his presence. But I read this book, and it says that God's presence has been with us in several ways. And I have illustrated about how God lived in a tent along with his people through the wilderness wanderings and the Exodus experience. And it tells me about a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. It tells me about his presence in a place called the Holy of Holies and something that's called the Shekinah glory of God. It's an awesome concept. And I read about how David had his son Solomon build a temple in Jerusalem, and both the tabernacle and the temple had this little room called the Holy of Holies. And in that Holy of Holies, the Holy of Holies, there was the presence of God that was so awesome that you could not stand in his presence. The high priest could go in once a year, and he had to behave himself really carefully, or they would drag him out with a rope tied around his big toe. You know. I read in the New Testament about the atoning work of Jesus and how Jesus Christ is the one that makes it possible for us to come to God. And the gospel is that since Jesus atoned for our sin, that now it's possible for all of us to just step into his presence. We don't have to go to Jerusalem. Don't have to find a temple or a tabernacle. He's everywhere. And you and I are invited to come into his presence. And he's made it easy to do that. So I look at this and I find that here in this passage in Hebrews, there's an invitation, first of all, to intimacy. It says, let us draw near to God. Wait a minute, God is scary. Yeah, let us draw near to God. But when God speaks from Mount Sinai, he scares the people of Israel, and they say to Moses, don't ever let God speak to us again, man. That's awesome. Why don't you just speak to us instead? But now we're in the New Testament, and we're to come near to God. We're to come with a sincere heart, and we're to come with assurance of faith. God isn't scary. There's a story about Abraham Lincoln when he was president. He had a little son called Todd. Todd was probably about 5 or 6. In one of those occasions, President Lincoln was with a cabinet meeting in his office, in the Oval Office, and he had some pretty heavy things going on. And Todd had a problem, and he needed his dad. So he came storming up the stairs, and he came running down the hall, and there was a soldier stationed at the door. And Todd came to run to the door, and the soldier reached out and grabbed him. And the soldier said, "Son, you can't go in there. The president is in session." Todd looked up at the soldier and said, "Your president, he's my father, and I'm going to talk to him." And he wiggled from the soldier and ran through the door. And President Lincoln rolled his chair out from behind his desk and said, "What is it, son?" And Todd had a moment with his father in the cabin waiting. You and I have a right to come to God anywhere, anytime, and it's never too busy. Isn't that awesome? That's what the writer to the Hebrews is trying to tell us here. So, all through the New Testament, there's this welcome that comes. I read the Christmas story. The shepherds were invited to come see. Now the shepherds were outcasts. They couldn't wash their hands every time they went to eat and stuff, and you know, they just couldn't do all the little ceremonial things, so they were considered unclean. They're outcasts. But it's to them that the angels first announced the good news. Wise men were invited to come to Bethlehem to see. They're foreigners. They're not like us. You know, we need to build a wall and keep them out, maybe. No, they were invited to come see. I read in the New Testament that the common people, in the Jewish synagogues, they just couldn't handle Jesus, so they asked him not to come to church anymore. You know, you kind of make a mess when you come. Why don't you just not come anymore? But out on the hillside, the common people came to hear him gladly. There's this invitation to come. And in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible I read, the Spirit and the Bride say, "Come." And let him who hears say, "Come." Whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. Wow. You and I have so much of a benefit over what others have. But the coming is not to satisfy a curiosity. The coming is for the help we need, the hope we long for, the fellowship we crave, and the eternal life that we have got to have. The third thing I see in this is that the writer in this passage is talking about a means of cleansing. In the Bible, water is used as a symbol of cleansing, but for sin, nothing cleanses except shed blood. Because you see, the moral law is that if you sin, you die. And it's from way back in Genesis, nothing has changed down through the years. But the writer to the Hebrews says, by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, opened for us through the curtain, the curtain, that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God. Wow. Someone has come and has made a provision. This theme of blood runs throughout the Bible, and I talked to you about the crimson cord, you know, and how Rahab was saved because of the crimson cord. And so we have this crimson cord idea, and sure enough, right worship always involves blood. Remember the story of Cain and Abel? Abel brought a blood sacrifice. Cain brought a grain offering. Works versus shed blood. The giving of a life. The tabernacle and the temple both have the rituals of animal sacrifices. The shed blood, the shed blood, the shed blood. but it never quite satisfies until that which is eternal sheds his blood for us. And he calls it a new and living way is open for us. It wasn't about building a temple or a church somewhere. It's about the body of Jesus broken for us. Isn't that an interesting symbol? Jesus said, this is my body temple. Not just the curtain, but the whole thing broken wide open. So you can come freely. You see, that which was veiled, hidden away in the tabernacle, in the Holy of Holies, that which was veiled by the human body of Jesus is revealed. It's opened up so that we can find God and come. Wow! What a passage of Scripture, huh? So in Jesus, justice is satisfied. And if you and I will accept him and his sacrifice on our behalf, we can have his life, eternal life. The fourth thing is that there's a hope to hold on to. The writer says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. You know, we have hope. Man, everybody's looking for that. Hang on to it. Don't turn loose of it. Oh, there'll be some issues that come along, and it can be lost in just one generation if we don't tell our kids and our grandkids. And there will be times when you and I will be tempted to turn loose of our hope. Man, it just looks like God's not going to answer, God's far away, and everything's going black. Hang on to your hope. What we have in Jesus is hope. He proved in the resurrection that he can handle anything. No other religion offers hope. Oh, they all offer a way. None of them offer hope. Folks, this isn't just a philosophy. This isn't just some kind of a ritual or a religion. This is based on the solid promise of God. You and I can hang on to that. Now, I want to move to the communion with that. And give me another slide, if you will.
Turn off.